So I think we've got everyone. And if you haven't gotten your mic to work, hopefully you can get it afterwards. But we're gonna start, if that sounds good. Yes.
Hello, everyone. I'm John Russell. I'm very happy to see all of you. Today. I see a lot of familiar faces here, and some people I haven't met before. But it's good to see all of you. And I wish you a happy 2021. So for this new year, I have some good news and bad news for you. The good news is that we are in a new year, 2021. The bad news is that the first lesson of this year will be a grammar lesson. I know, it's terrible news, but I think we will. We have a fun lesson planned for you today, and I look forward to exploring it with all of you. So, to get started, I'd like all of you to think about a time. Perhaps you're speaking with an English speaker and you want to describe the day that something happened, the night that something took place, the year that something happened. Okay? One way we describe time in English is through the use of adjective clauses. Okay? The reason I wanted to cover this with you is because one problem that English learners often face is that they have difficulty making more elaborate sentences, or they give a certain amount of information in several small sentences, whereas normally English speakers would combine this information into one sentence. So I would like you to keep that idea in mind as we explore adjective clauses that describe times, such as the night something happened, the day something happened, and so on and so forth. I'd like to discuss just a few definitions or important ideas for understanding adjective clauses. And the first is the basic idea of what is a clause. What is a clause? Does one of the participants today know what a clause is?
I think a clause should have a subject and a verb in a clause.
Yes, exactly. That's correct, Son. So a clause is a group of words, and it has a subject and a verb, or a subject and a predicate. We in English, we have basically two kinds of clauses. We have an independent clause and a dependent clause. Okay, an independent clause means an independent clause is a complete sentence. It can stand on its own. It's independent, like a country, for example. It's its own thing. So for example, if I said, I love English grammar, that is an independent clause. It's a complete sentence. The subject is I, and then the predicate is love English grammar. Okay? Then we have dependent clauses. Dependent clauses are clauses that play a part in a larger sentence, but they do not stand as their own sentences. So they add more information. So just to be clear, we have independent clauses, which are their own sentence, okay? And a dependent clause, which plays a part in a larger sentence. When we talk about adjective or relative clauses, we are in the world of dependent clauses. That means they depend on other parts of the sentence. Okay? Specifically, the kinds of clauses we'll look at today, they act like adjectives. They describe or give more information about a noun. So for example, if you saw the words red car, okay? Car is the noun and red is a color, but it's describing the car, right? It's describing the car. It's acting like an adjective, okay? Those are adjectives you're probably familiar with. In this case, what we are talking about, adjective clauses, they come after the noun, but they describe it. So for example, if we say, so here you can see it written, this is the car that I bought. Once again, the car is the important noun. And afterwards, we have this, we have an adjective clause. It also describes the car, but it comes afterwards. And notice it has a subject here, I, and bought, okay? So this, that I bought, is an adjective clause, okay? That's what we're talking about today. Are any of you familiar with some kinds of words that introduce adjective clauses in English? Have you heard any of these words before?
Which?
Yasmin said which. I think that definitely is one.
Yes, absolutely, Yasmin. Which is one of them. So we have that, which. What are other words?
Sun has one.
I think we have who, whom, or where, or when.
Yeah, right. So we have who, whom, where, and when, okay? So if we think about all of these, we have that, which, where, when, who, whom, you know, you get the idea that there are a lot of them. And so you might think, oh no, there are so many of these words that introduce adjective clauses. How do I know which ones to use? The good news is that you might see a lot of these terms in English grammar books, but the reality is that in most cases, English speakers don't necessarily use them. So for example, if we have our list here of, say we have six here. So for example, this one, whom, you will almost never hear this in everyday speech. Okay, you will almost never hear it. Now, when we come back to describing times, remember this is adjective clauses that describe times, there are really only a couple that you need to be concerned about, okay? And that is when, that, or another option, nothing. So when English speakers use adjective clauses to describe times, there are only a couple ways they actually do that. So you don't have to worry about learning a bunch of words for this because there are only a few possibilities that you will hear in everyday speech. So we have that, when, or they just don't use any word at all. They just drop it out, which is probably the easiest option because you don't have to remember it. All right. So if we took a sentence, for example, that was the day he left. That was the day he left. So for example, we have the noun here. The noun of time is day. And then this, he left. This is the adjective clause that describes day. And notice there's no word here. English speakers drop it out often. This is one of the patterns that you need to know. So that was the day he left. There's no special word introducing it.
I think sometimes we can remove the word that, right?
Yes, exactly, Sam.
I don't know if people would know this song, but I know one song called "Grow to You," and it goes like this: Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are near? So I think in that we have the clause for the time. Every time you are near.
Yes, exactly. Yes. So in this case, the noun of time is the word time itself. So every time you are near. But so the important point here, so you can drop it out, but if you were to say it with the word that, every time that you are near. Every time that you are near, you could also say that as well. It's acceptable. It's no problem. So the important point is that you can drop it out if you want.
That is the day when he left. Can you use the when?
Yes. Yeah. So this is this will be our the next one that we cover. For right now, yes, you are correct. You can use when. For right now, we'll just focus on just dropping out the word completely, and then we'll look at some examples with when as well. But you are correct. This is a nice thing about adjective clauses that describe times is that there's more flexibility in how you can say them. But the first one I really want you to know is just dropping the word out completely, like the example that San gave. So every time you are near. The reason I like this approach is because it's less for you to remember. It's just dropping out a word. Yeah. Has anyone else heard of heard some examples of songs or heard this used in everyday speech? The idea of dropping out the word completely. San gave one example.
Imagine there is no word.
Yeah, imagine there's no word. Yes, example. So this one is a song by the Monkees. We don't have to listen to it now, but it gives you an idea of this grammar point that we're describing, and it's called On the Day We Fall in Love. In this one, the noun of time is the word day. So on the day, and they don't use a special word to introduce the adjective clause, and it is we fall in love. So on the day we fall in love. So I have a question. If we were going to use this idea, if you were speaking with an English speaker and you wanted to describe a noun of time, for example, the word, say, just the word day, how would you use an adjective clause to describe it?
It's just another day we go to office.
In this case, we would say, for example, today is the day I go into the office. So we have today is the day is the main part of the sentence. And then the word that is dropped out. So we say today is the day I go into the office.
The day I joined TALK2US for the first time was wonderful.
The first day I joined TALK2US was wonderful, or something like that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. And if everyone could look in the chat box, I'm going to send a message. And I would like you all to read this message and think how you would combine those two sentences into one sentence that uses an adjective clause. So the two sentences I sent are, Friday is the day, and I will visit him then.
Okay, I think it could be, Friday is the day that I will visit him.
Yes, absolutely. So you could say, Friday is the day that I will visit him, or dropping the word out, Friday is the day I will visit him.
And we will remove the word then.
Yes, and you would remove the word then. So if you look at the screen, if you look at the chat box now, I just sent the answer. So we have Friday is the day I will visit him then becomes Friday is the day I will visit him.
7th of December is the day that we celebrate lighting candles.
Lighting candles. Very mm-hmm. nice.
And the lighting candles, what does that represent? The lighting of the candles, is it does it represent a larger idea?
Yes, it represents the idea of the Virgin, because we have a Catholic tradition. It's more religious.
Yes, 23 April in Turkey, Children's Days, National Days, we are celebrating 23 April every year.
Okay. So the 23rd of April is the day we celebrate National Children's Day?
Yes.
In Mexico, the 2nd November, we celebrate some beautiful tradition, the day of the day.
Good. So for an example, a way you could use this, the sentence structure that we've been discussing is, for example, if you need to correct someone. So for example, if I said, oh, November 5th is the day that, or November 5th is Day of the Dead. And you could say, oh, no, I'm sorry, November 2nd is the day we celebrate the Day of the Dead. This is how you could use this. Uh-huh.
Okay. In February, we hold July Ashes Day. Is we breathe to the people worldwide Ashes Day.
Ashes.
So Diego, the way you could say this, you could say it a slightly different way. You could say February is the month we celebrate Ashes Day. So if you don't want to say, for example, a specific day, you could say February is the month we celebrate Ashes in, you know, is the month in which we celebrate Ashes Day. I guess that would be slightly different, but.
1st May, the day we enjoy holiday.
Great. What's the name of the holiday?
It's 1st May, it's a Labor Day, so enjoy holiday.
Oh, okay, got it. So it's Labor Day. I guess it's an international holiday. Yeah. All right, wonderful.
Well, I'll ask for more examples here. The second structure I wanted to talk about. So the first one we have is the noun of time. So Friday is the day I will visit him. Remember, there's no word that introduces the adjective clause. The second common pattern you'll hear English speakers use is the word when. So the noun of time, when. So for an example, in the Everyday Grammar article that I wrote, I gave this example from a singer named John Anderson. And the song says, "There was a time when I was all right by myself." Did anyone hear the noun of time in that sentence? What's the important noun of time?
I think that the noun is time.
Yes, exactly. In this case, the noun of time is the word time. So there was a time when I was alone. Okay, that is the title of the song. Okay, and then it goes on, I was all right by myself. So here we have the sentence, there was a time when I was alone, okay? And as San said, the noun of time that we are interested in here is the word time itself. There was a time, and notice how notice how John Anderson begins this adjective clause. He uses the word when, okay? So there was a time when I was alone. Okay, so this is our second common pattern. So the first was English speakers don't use any word to introduce the adjective clause. And in this case, he used the word when to introduce the adjective clause. Okay? I have another question for you, similar to the one I sent before. So if you look in the chat box, you'll see the following sentence. February is the month. The weather is usually cold in that month. How would you rearrange those two sentences to make them into one sentence that uses the word when?
Yes, when February comes, is usually cold.
Oh, okay. So you did use the word when. You're correct. You used a slightly different grammatical structure than the one we are today. But yes, that is one acceptable way to say it. Yes. Can we have? Is there another way to say these two sentences?
Yes. February is the month when it's usually cold.
Okay, good. So Lena said February is the month when it is usually cold. That is very good. Yes, that is what I had in mind. So I will type this in the chat box as well so everyone can see it. So February is the month when it is usually cold. This is one way that you could rearrange those two sentences. So notice, you know, you could say all of that information in two sentences. February is the month. The weather is usually cold in that month. But if you combine them in one sentence, exactly what Lena said, February is the month when it is usually cold. All right. And so you might hear this, for example, if you're someone asks you, like, in your country, what month is usually the coldest? And someone might say, oh, you know, in my country, you know, June is the month when it is usually cold. Okay. Would someone like to give an example to talk about their country and the month when it is hottest?
February is a month which we wear more clothes when the weather is usually cold.
Okay. Well, yes, we can say February is the month when it is usually cold. Uh-huh. You can say February is the month in which it is usually cold. You can use that. But I will say when using it in an adjective clause, the in which is much less common in speaking. So people do use it. I didn't want to discuss it too much today because I would say in general, it's less common than the other structures that we have discussed so far. So the most common, if you look in everyday speech, is going to be no word to begin the adjective clause, or when, or the word that, in which is much less common. Uh-huh. So, for example, if I said, Yasmin, in Egypt, January is usually the hottest month, isn't it?
August is the month when it is the hottest.
Yes, August is the month when it is hottest, or August is the month when it is usually hot. Uh-huh.
Lihoi was asking, can I say February is the month in which it is usually cold?
Yeah, and yes, and so that was the one I mentioned. You could use in which. It's less common. You'll hear it in every speaking. Yeah, in speaking, people, it's less common. I mean, it's acceptable, absolutely, and understood. But for today, I wanted to explore with you the most common ways that people speak. Uh-huh.
In July is the month when the rain is starting.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great example. Yeah. So it is the month when the rain is strongest. Yeah. And so if you look in the meeting chat, I'm sending some of the common nouns of time that you will see. So today we've talked about, you know, using no word after the noun of time, possibly using the word that or using the word when. But I wanted to send you a few more common nouns of times. So you could use these when you're describing something that happened. So for example, we've gone through day. For time, we could say, you know, for example, 6 a.m. is the time when I wake up. Or for example, if you're talking about New Year's Eve, for example, midnight is the time when everybody celebrates. You can take let's take the word year. Everyone can describe perhaps they can make up a year that they were born or that their kid was born or something, or their parents were born. So I might say, you know, 1950 was the year my dad was born. Okay. In this case, 1950 was the year. And then my dad was born. I don't use any special word to introduce the adjective clause. Can anyone make up a date and talk about the year that something happened?
I meet my relatives, my grandparents, once a year.
Okay. You meet them once a year. So in this case, you would say, when do you meet them? Is it a month? Do you meet them in a month?
On festivals, once a year, festival.
Okay, and in what month is that festival?
This is September. September.
Okay, so September is the month when I meet with my relatives. This is how you might use. So September is the month when I meet with my relatives, for example. Uh-huh, good, excellent. All right, and so what about a year? Can anyone think of a year?
I never forgot a time when my good friends say goodbye to me.
Oh, that's a very heartfelt example, David.
A
yes.
Sad one.
A sad one, yeah. Yeah, I will never forget the time when my friends said goodbye to me. Yes.
Yes,
very good.
Can I use a moment replace a time in the sentence? I never forget a moment.
Yeah, yes. So typically because a moment is like it's hard to describe a moment because it's a very short period of time. It doesn't really have a specific meaning. You know, a moment, maybe it's like a second, less than a second. But we typically use with the definite article, we use the word the. So I will never forget the moment he told me goodbye. For example, I will never forget the moment my friend told me goodbye. Or I will never forget the moment I will never forget the moment I realized I would never see my friend again, for example. So that's how you could use moment. So yes, that is another noun of time. That one is a little trickier to use, David, just because a moment is kind of like it's an unspecified, very small amount of time. We usually use this with like realizations or when something very sudden happens. Yes.
See, Chem has one that he shared.
Okay, yes. So Chem said, I told them that maybe we could visit them next year when we should have. Oh, yes. So that's an excellent example, Chem. The one piece of advice I would say is you actually don't need the modal in this case. You don't need should. So you could say, I told them that maybe we could visit them next year when we have free time. The reason you don't need the modal, the reason is because in the first part of your sentence, you already have maybe in there. So it already suggests that it's not fixed, you know. So you could just say, I told them that maybe we could visit them next year when we have more free time, or when we have free time.
2007 is the year when I married.
Okay.
Oh yeah. So that's an excellent example. The one correction, this is an unusual thing we do in English. We typically say when I got married. So we use the verb got. So 2007 is the year when I got married. Yeah. That's a tricky one, that weird verb we use, the verb get. Yeah.
Yes, in 1996 when I bought the first my car.
Okay, so 1996 is the year when
I bought my first car.
Oh, okay. So 1996 is the year when you bought your first car. Yeah, excellent. Excellent. That's a very good example. Yeah.
2019 is the year when COVID-19 appeared.
Oh, yes. So that's a very, very news-focused one. Yes, you are correct. So 2019 is the year when COVID-19 first appeared. Yes, that's a very good good example. Yes,
I can say 2000 was the year when the century changed.
Yeah.
Yes, 1915 was the time my parents came to Uruguay. When my parents came to Uruguay.
Oh, okay. 1916 was the year when my parents came to. Or to Uruguay. That's a great.
Yes. Yeah.
I want to ask. Yes. Why sometimes John used to the year followed by is or was?
Oh, so yeah, that's a good question. So it's kind of a question of style when you think about it. So 1916 was the year when my parents came to Uruguay, or you could say 1916 is the year when my parents came to Uruguay. I think the difference might be, for example, for Maria, one, if she was just narrating her own family history, she might, if she was presenting to a bunch of people, she might say, oh, 1916 was the year when my parents came to Uruguay. Whereas if she was correcting someone, so for example, if Maria's daughter was saying, oh, 1918 was the year when, you know, your grandparents came to Uruguay, and Maria might say, oh, no, 1916 is the year when my, you know, grandparents came to Uruguay. So that it's a subtle question of style. Yeah. So that one, it's less about the grammar and more about conversation, a subtlety in conversation, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Thank you so much, John Russell, for sharing about adjective clauses, because it's something that we do a lot in English, but we don't necessarily think about it. And you really helped us realize how we can use them, or, you know, invisibly use them.
Yeah, well, thank you, Armin, and thank you to everybody who came into this class. It's always a joy for me to be able to see and speak to you.
Until we see you next, we're very happy that you're with us, and have a wonderful day, everyone.